I think it's interesting. It helps you to understand how many things work. I mean, you can wonder about many other things, like why people get sick, for example, okay, or various technologies, but you don't think about that on a daily basis. Whereas, you know, just following the news or thinking about what is happening to you, why people act the way they act, I think naturally brings you to economics. Maybe psychology as well, but also economics. No, I think with economics being the an imperialistic science, I think it's rather the other way around, meaning that economics is the new psychology. Is people take ideas from psychology, they import them into economics, and then they build models around that. Okay, so I know Matthew Rabin or even people like Kahneman, Tversky would be examples of that. So Kahneman originally is a psychologist, and Tversky, and they bring ideas from psychology, formalize them, and introduce them to economists. Okay. Or there is also Matthew Rabin or Martin Duffenberg, Gary Charnas. They work on these ideas of psychological game theory, where essentially what people care about is not only the material outcome of the game, but also how you get to that outcome. And what I mean by that is they care about, so players care about things like intentions of other players, okay? So do you get to your outcome through a good intention or a bad intention or just randomly, okay? And this actually affects material payoff. Okay. So one example would be, suppose that you sit in a bar and somebody comes by and basically knocks you off your chair, okay? So basically the outcome is you're lying on the floor being knocked off your chair, okay? And traditional game theory says this is what you care about, right? But essentially psychological game theory also cares about, well, why did that happen? Why did you end up being knocked down on the floor by someone else, right? And suppose there are two scenarios. One is somebody just is rude to you or wants to harm you and just knocks you off the chair. So then you perceive the harmful intention behind this act, and your actions down the road are affected by this perception. Whereas suppose somebody did it because there was some object that was just about to fall on you as you were sitting on the chair. And so essentially this person was trying to save you, right? So you would react completely differently to this kind of act, okay? So I think these are very interesting ideas, and I'm glad they are being brought into economics. I think the origin is the ideas were imported into economics, then some people started developing theories of this, and after that people started testing it, and because you have to have sort of great control over intentions and also maybe beliefs in some cases, lab is a natural place to test these theories, okay? But it's just a place to test them, really. I mean, it's mostly about thinking why people behave the way they behave. I'm not sure I would sort of criticize testing these theories. I think this is exactly what we should be doing, okay? You can argue with methodologies of particular papers, but I think as the overall research agenda, testing these theories is a good idea, because you kind of want to see what predictions you actually get in the lab and which ones you don't, right? Because ultimately you would like to have a theory that you believe actually describes behavior, and you can take it from one environment to another, okay? So I think it's a natural research agenda that we look at predictions of these theories and test them. And yes, I mean, I go to experimental conferences, and not all papers do this successfully, okay? Also, Some experimentalists run their lab studies without really having a very firm theory behind some behavior, okay? And this may give you interesting results, but it is hard to interpret them, and you don't know how they translate to other environments because you have no theory behind it. I mean, there are issues, obviously. Whenever you run a study in a lab, you run it in a particular way. And so you may ask how much of whatever result you get may be due to particular methods or perhaps subject pool that you use, okay? But I think in this respect, experimental economics is not really different from other empirical areas of economics. Let's say in labor economics, you also look at a particular pool of people, okay? These may be workers in a particular sector or a particular country or of a particular age, and you try to extrapolate whatever you learn from this set to kind of general population, okay? So I think you run the same risks as in lab studies. Now, you may, of course, counter that in field studies, be it, you know, natural occurring data or field experiments, people are in a natural environment, whereas in the lab they are not. And this is surely true, and this is the advantage of basically using naturally occurring data or using field experiments, okay? On the other hand, though, if you really want to test theories, usually you need to measure things that are hard to measure in the field, okay? And this could be things like you need to get some idea about preferences, let's say, for risk, for competition, time preferences, social preferences, whatever. And this is difficult to measure in a way that subject wouldn't notice that this is an experiment, right? So once you want to measure these things, you have to admit you're doing an experiment. And then, yes, you can do it in a lab or you can do it in a field. So there's, I would say, in field experiments, there are two branches. One is what you can call lab in the field. Okay, so essentially, this is like running a lab study, except that you kind of try to do it in a more natural environment for subjects. Whereas a truly field study would basically place subjects in a situation where they are not aware that they are in the experiment, okay? But again, then it is hard to measure things like beliefs, preferences, which may be necessary for interpreting the results. So, look, I think there are issues with experimental economics, but I don't think they are fundamentally different than in other areas of economics. So, there's a lot of data mining going on, I think, both in and outside of experimental economics. And this is not right, obviously. People should formulate their hypothesis and then do a study and then test the hypothesis, right? So I think, you know, I think that happens, but it's not really different from other areas of economics. So I think not all questions are well suited for experimental economics, okay? Particularly I do lab studies, so maybe I speak more for lab side than field side. I mean, I think it's hard to do things like, let's say, corruption studies in the lab, okay? Or something like studies on how managers behave if you don't actually bring managers into the lab, okay? So I fully admit to this, and I also tell my students whenever they come to me, say, with an idea to do research on things like corruption or tax evasion, I say this is very difficult to do in the lab. In general, it's very difficult to do, okay? So there are limitations, okay? On the other hand, I think there are a lot of areas where we can learn something about how people behave. And that's where we should focus our efforts. Okay, so basically, a few years ago we started thinking about behavioral auction design, Okay, what is this about? So the idea is whether we can actually bring some of these ideas from psychology, or rather, let me put it this way, behavioral economics, into design of auctions. Okay. Before, economists thought a lot about design of auctions, but they were using traditional expected utility theory based on self-regarding preferences. Okay? So our idea was, can we bring some of these observations from behavioral economics to exploit them in design of auctions, either for better revenue or better efficiency, whatever the objective of the auctioneer might be. Now, one interesting thing we came across is the effect of anticipated regret, or general regret on bidding. Okay, so the idea here is that ex post, after you learn the outcome of the auction, you might have some negative feelings about foregone opportunities. So, for example, suppose we study first price seal bid auction, which means that there is one object for sale, and a set of bidders each submit independently their bid for the object, and the highest bid wins, the others don't. Okay. And so the idea is that if you place a bid and you learn that you did not succeed, and you learn what the highest bid was, you might realize that maybe if you knew that, then ex post you would be better off actually placing an even higher bid. Okay. But obviously you can't do that anymore. So the idea is that you might regret this ex post. Or likewise, if you win the auction and you learn how high the second highest bid was, you might regret having placed too high a bid, and ex post you might prefer to reduce it. But again, you can't do it anymore. So the question is whether you can manipulate how people bid depending on what feedback you promise to give them after the auction. Okay? And we studied three particular cases. One is what we call minimal feedback. Bidders are only told after the auction whether they won or not. And alternatively, we consider what we call loser feedback. This means that after the auction, bidders are also told the winning bid. Okay? And the third one we consider is winner feedback. That's a situation where the winner is informed about the second highest bid. So there is some work in the American Economic Review which claims that you can actually manipulate how people bid by provision of feedback, with the idea being that if you provide loser feedback, you sort of tune people to the possibility that they might regret not having placed a higher bid ex post. And so this, the story goes, might induce bidders to bid higher, which is very interesting because from the point of view of getting more revenue for the auctioneer, this is an interesting way of increasing bids. Okay, so basically there is a study in the American Economic Review which says that this works. So providing loser feedback as opposed to minimal feedback increases bids. And there's also a theoretical section in the paper which explains why this happens, and it's related to these ideas of regret. Okay, but importantly, what you need to have is you need to have subjects, or generally bidders, to anticipate this possibility of regret when they bid. And second, you also have to have that feedback somehow makes you more aware of this loser regret. Loser feeling makes you more aware of loser regret, ex ante. Okay. Well, so basically we thought about this theory, and we found it to be an interesting, idea, but we found it to be theoretically unsatisfactory because essentially it's a theory by assumption. So we were thinking of building an alternative theory that could also explain this finding, but could also help us to understand what happens when you provide some other type of feedback, not just the three types I mentioned before. So we designed basically a study which would allow us to test the theory we were thinking about, which was based on posterior belief distortions. The idea would be that if exposed, you learn that you lost in the auction and you're potentially subject to regret, you might try to convince yourself that the winning bid was perhaps very much above your own bid, and so there is no need to regret not having placed a slightly higher bid, let's say. But to our surprise, when we ran our initial set of experimental sessions, we could not get the effect that was reported in this American Economic Review study. So in a sense, there was no job to do with our new theory because there was no empirical effect there. Okay? But this was very puzzling because we didn't get the effect, whereas that study did. But there were some differences in our initial implementation compared to their study. So then we ran another two sets of sessions, which gradually brought our design closer and ultimately exactly to their design. And we still couldn't find any effect. Okay, so basically, this version of the paper simply says, okay, we have this very large-scale study by lab experimental standards. We manipulate feedback in first prize auction and we do not find any effect. And we also elicit emotions, subject emotions, how they feel after the auction. And we argue through these emotions that basically the reason why we think the effect of feedback does not work, especially when the channel is regret, is because A, in a one-shot environment, bidders do not sufficiently anticipate this regret. And second, because the type of feedback is not effective in changing salience of different kinds of regret, meaning if I move you from minimal to loser feedback, it doesn't mean that you will suddenly become more worried about loser regret. So that's sort of a reflection on the theory. Okay? And that's what the Monday seminar was about. So it's quite a few other things actually. With Michal Bauer and Lanshava, we have a project which looks at transmission of social preferences from parents to children, meaning if children behave in a pro-social way, or generally if people behave in a pro-social way, where do they get these preferences from originally? Right? And this kind of, I think, is a contribution to the debate on where these social preferences originate from. Okay, and we argue that they, to a large extent, originate from family upbringing, which doesn't rule out other sources, but there's a high correlation between social preferences of parents and social preferences of children. So that's one project. Another project we are looking at, again, in the laboratory. So this was a field experiment, but in the laboratory we're looking at how people behave in choice under risk if you frame it differently. So particularly one framing is a so-called gain framing and another framing is a so-called loss framing. So gain framing means that your perception is that in the risky situation you can only gain, okay? Whereas the loss framing is a framing where in a risky situation you can only lose, but essentially you have a choice in the gain situation between a sure gain and a larger risky gain, okay? Whereas in a loss situation you have a choice between sure loss or a larger loss but with a probability of 50%, okay? And so the question is, how do people choose in these two situations that are essentially identical from the point of view of money you end up with? So this is, in a sense, inspired by an old idea from a paper by Kahneman and Tversky, who find that people make much more risk-averse choices when you frame the lottery as a gain, and much less risk-averse choices when you frame it as a loss. So we revisit this issue, and one interesting finding is that men are not very sensitive to gain versus loss framing, whereas women are. So part of my research is on gender differences, and this kind of is continues in that line of research, which is interesting because if we know that different framing of the same decision situation leads to different decisions, okay, then this is something that can be used either in policy, or this is something that maybe decision makers should be made aware of so that they can perhaps, I don't want to say correct, but maybe adjust their decisions. Okay, so that's another project. I'm about to run yet another project which deals with understanding why people display cooperative behavior in contributions to public goods. And the idea here is really to sort of take various models of social preferences and try to understand which particular feature of the social preferences may explain why people behave in cooperative way. Different alternatives being reciprocity, conformity, inequality, aversion. And the idea of the experiment is to differentiate among these alternative potential explanations. So, and then I have a few other projects, so yeah, I could go on for another 10 minutes, I guess. Let me start with something I noticed among several second-year students, okay? So I think they come with an observation, empirical observation, and their agenda is to prove it in the lab, okay, through using an experiment. So I think this is not the way to go, okay? And there are two reasons for it. First, one shouldn't kind of approach a research idea with sort of intention of proving something. Okay? It sounds like almost a foregone conclusion. And second, I think it's always useful to think about how findings of a study can be used. Okay? And one should probably have in mind either some sort of a theory testing exercise or some interesting fact-finding mission that can be extrapolated in a fairly straightforward way, or maybe some sort of a policy type of message, okay? But I think a good experiment, or thinking about a good experiment, is you really have to first think about how you extrapolate your finding to other domains and other situations, because this is when your results become interesting, because other people say, this is interesting, this could also apply to this situation and this situation and this situation, right? Whereas if you study one isolated environment with an unclear message for how the results extrapolate, this is less interesting. So I think my advice would be really think about exercises, the results of which can be easily extrapolated to other domains. And then you have a message. A message is what really counts here. So maybe this is too loose. So okay, now I think in terms of where to start, I think one needs to decide what sort of field or area he or she is interested in. And then the next step is to really have a good grasp of the literature in that area, okay? And I think then it's good to perhaps discuss with an advisor, a faculty member, okay, based on what one read, what is the big picture, okay? And once sort of once you understand the big picture and where the findings are at the moment, then you can start thinking about in which direction you can extend the knowledge. Okay? So I think this is also an important message for students, because I think I often encounter a situation where a student comes with some idea without really having a good knowledge of the literature. Okay. And I'm happy to provide some references, but sometimes I also encounter situations when references are on the syllabus and students still have not really got familiar with the literature. So I think it's I think it's important to know where the knowledge is in that area before you can really start contributing to it. Okay, so this is very important. Now, this is not to say that you cannot have some original idea that drives your interest, okay? But you cannot have just that. You also have to know what others have done before you. I remember that the same problem from the time when I was a graduate student, that in a sense you read and you seem that there's no room left for your own research. But I have to say that once you really sort of read the literature, you start finding more and more gaps. Okay? It's also important, I guess, to talk to other people to get some reflections on your perception of that area, because other people might have other ideas or other perceptions. But I think once you discover a first gap, then it's a very short way to discovering a second gap and a third gap and so on and so forth. One other way also, I think, might be to go and question some established findings or theories, but you have to have a good reason why you question it, okay? So not just saying, oh, I think, you know, this doesn't quite work, but you have to know why it doesn't work, because this is, in a sense, what will shape how you will approach your research topic, okay? So, so for example, one area where this this example would apply is behavioral industrial organization. Okay, so we have a lot of industrial organization IO models, theory models with lots of predictions. Okay, and so if you try to do some IO theory, it may be really difficult. A lot has been done. You know, it may be difficult to find your gap. But once you sort of start questioning whether, let's say, consumers in particular behave exactly in ways in which traditional IO tells us they do, then and you also explain why you have your doubts and what do you think is really different, then actually you suddenly have an opening for all sorts of things. Okay, you can study how markets work under different assumptions about consumer behavior, for example. Okay, so it's not just sort of finding gaps in what has been done. It's also questioning established findings, but you have to have good reason to question.